In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God.
He said unto them, Go ye into all the world, and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. And these signs shall follow them that believe. In my name shall they cast out devils, they shall speak with new tongues, they shall take up serpents, and if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover.
Though our sins are scarlet, you've made us white as snow. Though our sins are scarlet, you have made us white as snow.
Name for it, it's Dooms. It's a miracle that it wasn't Doomsday. I'm glad to be here in one piece tonight. Everybody said hallelujah. We have had a great time in California, and I have preached a few youth meetings in the last 10 years, but I don't know when I have ever preached to a more on fire, electric, dynamic group of young people than what I'm preaching to tonight. There is an explosion subject to happen at any given moment. I believe I am in the midst of apostolic elitists. I mean the best. I mean the Royal Guard. I mean the Marine Corps. I mean the best right here in California. We've got it right here. Now the last couple of nights I have preached what God has given me. I will try to follow Him every night. I have not intended to preach as though I think you're backslid. You're not backslid. But I am telling you, if we ever needed preaching, we need it right now. I said we need it right now. We're leaving a millennium, we're going into a next one, and we need revival like we've never had. And we need preaching like we've never had. When you get home, you need to say, pour it on, preacher, hotter, heavier, and longer than you have ever preached it in the history of your ministry. I'm not as worried about having pizza as I am going to heaven. I'm not as interested in entertainment as I am in living an eternity forever with Jesus Christ. The book of Luke tonight, chapter 5. And it came to pass, verse 1, as the people pressed upon him to hear the word of God, he stood by the lake of Gennesaret and saw two ships standing by the lake, but the fishermen were gone out of them and were washing their nets. And he entered into one of the ships, which was Simon's, and prayed him that he would thrust out a little from the land. And he sat down and taught the people out of the ship. Now when he had left speaking, he said unto Simon, launch out into the deep, and let down your nets for a draught. And Simon answering said unto him, Master, we have toiled all night and have taken nothing. Nevertheless, at thy word, I will let down the net. And when they had this done, they enclosed a great multitude of fishes, and their net brake. That's what happens when you fish with Jesus. And they beckoned unto their partners, which were in the other ship, that they should come and help them. I believe there's a revival big enough to go around all the whole state of California, where one church is going to have to call another church and say, hey, we need some help. And they came and filled both the ships so that they begin to sink. Now watch this. When Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord. For he was astonished, and all that were with him, at the draught of fishes which they had taken. And so was also James and John, the sons of Zebedee, which were partners with Simon. And Jesus said unto Simon, fear not, from henceforth thou shalt catch men. And when they had brought their ships to land, they forsook all and followed him. Watch this. Verse 8. When Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord. And I want to preach tonight by the help of Almighty God after He catches you. After He catches you. The Lord's about to go fishing tonight. The Lord has come into this building and He's got something to say. I wonder how many want to hear what the voice of the Lord would say tonight. Turn to a buddy and tell him, God, not for the glory of men, but for your glory, let there be a mighty demonstration of the Holy Ghost happen in this building. Turn to somebody and say, listen, I want to see a move of God like I've never seen in the history of my life. Not because of a preacher and not because we're just at youth camp, but because of the end time, I want to see a move of God like I've never seen it. If you want to see it, I want you to clap your hands, close your eyes, lift your head, clap your hands unto God and shout, Jesus, we can't do it without you, Lord. We've got to have a touch of the Holy Ghost. Not by might and power, but by my Spirit, saith the Lord. Hallelujah! Praise God. How many is going to help me preach tonight? God bless you, and you may be seated. Here we find some very intriguing things. The ministry of Jesus Christ is started. And He comes by a ship. And He is going to step into an occupation of a man by the name of Peter. He had one reason for showing up this day. It wasn't to prove that he could do anything. It wasn't to prove that he had power over the elements and that nature was driven by his command. He was not coming this day to catch fish, but he was coming to fish for an apostle. When he stepped on the scene at this very moment, Peter had already been fishing. He was a man that knew how to fish. He knew about barometric pressure. He knew about where to find and locate fish. And he knew at the proper depth to fish. And he had had a bad day of fishing. But Jesus stepped by on what must have been one of his worst fishing days. And he said, listen, I want you to go out and launch out into the deep. And I want you to cast your net out for a draught. I am about to prove to you something, Peter, that I am greater than you are. I'm stronger than you are. I have more ability than you do. And he stepped into a man that was very confident in his occupation. He knew how to fish, but he didn't know how to handle a bad day. But the master said, go out into the deep and try it again. Peter said, nevertheless, at thy word, we've told all night, but nevertheless, I'm listening to you. When he got out and cast the net out, suddenly there was so much pressure and activity in the net. I am telling you here tonight, it wasn't just to catch fish, but he was trying to catch Peter, and he caught him. Peter was astonished at what had happened. At simple obedience to the Word of God brought a miracle into his life. And suddenly at the other end of the net was more fish than he ever dreamed. He suddenly called the other ships and said, look, we don't have the power. This is more than we can handle. It's a catch bigger than our own self. He beckoned to the other ships, you've got to help us out here. Now before that happened, the Bible said he fell on his knees and he said, depart from me. Peter at that time, my friend, was caught. He said, this man can outfish me any day of the week. He stepped into Peter's world, not to catch fish, but to catch Peter. And he looked at Peter and he said, fear not, from henceforth thou shalt catch men. I'm here to tell you that right in the midst of some of your occupation, right in the midst of some of your good time, Jesus Christ filled you with the power of the Holy Ghost. He stepped into your world, not just so you can be a one God, apostolic, tongue-talking, holy, rolling, born-again believer and shout and run. But I am telling you, he has put the power of his Spirit in you so that you can reach a world that is lost and going to hell. We have got the power tonight to impact our world and to change it. I've got news for you. The greatest revival that California has ever seen hasn't happened yet. I'm telling you, the greatest revival is right now. It's right now. It's right now. It's right now. Why is God stepping into churches and stepping into our environment? It's not so we can put up our head and say we've got it. No, he's trying to catch us. And when he catches us, we're going to start catching men. He doesn't heal the sick and raise the dead. And every one of you has heard your pastor declare. You've seen miracles at the hand of the man of God in your life. But Jesus doesn't do it just so we can put up our head and say, thank God, another great thing has happened. It's so that something will take us to another dimension of faith. He can outfish you. He can out-hunt you. He can out-skate you. He can out-dribble you. I want to tell you that the master of the universe, he could do anything that you can do, and he can do it better. I'm telling you, he can do it better. Whatever he did, he's the best at it. He is the Messiah. He is the mighty God. He's the everlasting Father. He is the great I Am. Nothing is too hard for him to do. But he hasn't showed up in our presence just to make us have cold chills. You may be seated. And to make us feel good and special. He is trying to impact us so that we can impact the world. He wants us to know, I have chosen you in this last hour. I didn't choose you to be the first man out of the blocks. I believe that I am preaching to the anchor men and women of Pentecost. We are running the last lap. He didn't take some big overweight person that couldn't get the job done. But I believe there's lightning speed at the feet of young people here today that are not quick to run to mischief, but quick to run to apostolic power. He knows you can do it. He He knows you can do it, and He's going to use you to do it. And some of you are going to step into another dimension that you have never found before. You may be seated. You've caught me, Jesus. And that last verse says that they forsook all and began to follow Him. Because they were captured by this Messiah that could do anything and everything. And they were convinced that He was that mighty God, that everlasting Father, that Prince of Peace, and all power was at His hand. And right after that, if you'll keep reading in the chapter, you'll discover that miracles, they started being eyewitnesses of great power. You know why Jesus did that in their midst? So they would have confidence that they could do it in His absence. He was preparing them. He did miracles in their midst so that they could perform them in His absence. Listen to me just a moment. They had a physical Messiah with them. And Peter made some bold declarations. He said, I'm never going to leave you. I'm going to be here to the end. You can count on me, Master. I'm going to stay in the battle. I'm going to stay on the firing line. But he said, Simon, Satan hath desired to have you. He's trying to sift you as wheat. But I prayed for you. I have prayed for you. I am telling you that some of you are in the same position that Peter was. You have made that declaration. I'm never going to mess up. I'm going to stay here right until the end. I'm going to keep on fighting. I'm going to be faithful. You can count on me. And that's the way it's got to be. I'm telling you, we've got to make up our mind. I'm not giving up. I'm not surrendering. I'm not quitting. I'm not letting down. I'm not bowing to the pressure of this world. I'm going to keep on fighting with everything in me. And he walked with him. And he talked with him. And he became a part of an elite group. He became a part of a dynamic trio that got to witness some special things. He saw some things that other disciples didn't see because he chose a place of intimate relationship with the Messiah. I'm telling you, Peter saw some things that others maybe didn't see. And I hope tonight that you are a part of that group that sees the miraculous that Jesus wants you to see. You better make sure you're in the inner court of what God is doing in the earth. You better make sure that you're in the inner circle. I'm never going to leave you. But when it came betrayal time, and Judas Iscariot came up, Peter, he was doing good. Everything was going great. And suddenly, when that mob came, he took out a sword and cut off an ear, and it fell on the ground. Jesus said, wait a minute. It's not time to fight like that. Peter, I've got to go and die. But I have already called you. I've already planted keys and placed them in your hand. There is a call upon your life. And I have called you. And I'm going to use you. And there's going to be a mighty Pentecost in my absence. And you're going to be a part of it. But suddenly, going from a great distance off and following from afar, he ended up huddled up around a fire. The Lord had already told him, you're going to deny me. You're going to deny me before men. You're going to deny me. And you're not going to stand for me. And you're not going to be that representative that I need you to be. And it'd be just like the devil, who probably no doubt yelled loud in Peter's ears, this is going to disqualify you from ever being used of God in your future. You're one of them. No, I'm not. You're one of them. No, I'm not. You're one of them. Oh, no, I'm not. And suddenly there was the crowing of a cock Thank God it was not the finality of a leopard's cry, but it was the crowing of a cock that would signify every morning when you wake up. If you live in the country, a cock's going to crow, signifying that there's a brand new morning coming for you. And thank God it wasn't a final cry, but it was the crow of a cock signifying this is a new day, this is a new hour, this is going to be a new opportunity, another day of mercy for you, Peter. Now, walk with me quickly. Peter went back to his occupation. I want to tell you, sometimes when you make a mistake, you'll go back to the things that you love. I said, if you're not careful, you'll go back to what you love. Mistakes will tell you he don't love you. Just go back to your occupation. But Jesus had another plan. You see, he had plans for Peter's life. He wasn't going to give up on him. He wasn't going to quit. He was going to work with him as best he could. The Bible lets us know that Jesus, this would be the third time that he would appear to them. After his resurrection, he had already called them. They had already walked with him. The cock had already crowed. And Peter is wrestling on the inside. The Bible says, therefore, that disciple whom Jesus loved saith unto Peter, it is the Lord. Now when Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he girded his fisher's coat unto him, for he was naked, and did cast himself into the sea. And the other disciples come in a little ship, for they were not far from the land, but as it were 200 cubits, dragging the net with fishes. I want you to watch this. Jesus came back on the scene. This was after he had denied him. He told him to cast his net again, and it produced 153 fishes. What Jesus is trying to do is let him know, hey, I'm still Jesus. I can still outfish you. I'm still in charge. Don't give up on me. Now watch this. As soon as they were come to land, they saw a fire of coals there, and fish laid thereon, and bread. Notice that it was at a fire that Peter had denied him, but mercy built him another fire. It gave him another opportunity. Mercy put together another fire. Jesus saith unto them, bring of the fish which you have now caught. Simon Peter went up and drew the net to the land full of great fishes, 153. And for all there were so many, yet was not the net broken. Jesus saith unto them, come and dine. And none of the disciples durst ask him, who art thou? Knowing that it was the Lord. Jesus then cometh and taketh bread and giveth them, and fish likewise. This is now the third time that Jesus showed himself to the disciples after that he was risen from the dead. So when they had dined, they have already eaten. And Jesus looks Peter right in the eyes and he says, Peter, lovest thou me more than these? What I want to know, Peter, is do you love the product of your past occupation more than you love me? What I want to know, Peter, do you love the product of a past involvement more than you love me? Oh Lord, you know I love you. The second time, Peter, I hope you got a good taste of it. I hope you chewed it well. I hope you ran it around in your mouth and savored the taste of it. I've got to ask you the second time, do you love me more than you love these fish? Lord, you know I love you. First time was feed my lambs. The second time is feed my sheep. Peter, lovest thou me? more than thee. Lord, you're grieving. You know I love you. Young man, listen. Lord, you know I love you. Feed my sheep. And then Jesus said, now I'll prophesy. Verily, verily, I say unto thee, when thou wast young, thou girdest thyself, and walkest whither thou wouldest. But when thou shalt be old, thou shalt stretch forth thy hand, and another shall gird thee, and carry thee whither thou wouldest not. This spake he, signifying by what death he should glorify God. And when he had spoken this, he saith unto him, follow me. Now let me tell you what happened there. Mercy built him another fire. And a threefold denial called for a threefold affirmation. He said, you denied me three times. Now I want to know three times. Do you love me? Do you love me more than these? Do you love me more than these? For two nights, God has spoken to this body of youth, and he has asked for a commitment. Now God wants to take you to another dimension, and that is his commitment that he's willing to give to you if you're willing to make that commitment. God's going to commit some things to you. And he prophesied, and he said, now I want to tell you something that I have sensed. You're not going to be going back fishing anymore. Your days of your occupation's over. You're about to become a fisher of men like you have never been. Some of you in this building tonight are about to find another dimension of being used of God that you never dreamed. And the devil has told you because of your past mistake, you'll not be a preacher's wife. Get behind me, devil. Somebody said, I'll never teach Bible studies. I've made too many mistakes. I'll never be able to be the right hand that my pastor needs me to be. I've made too many mistakes. But Jesus is just asking, lovest thou me more than these? Lovest thou me more than these? Lovest thou me more than these? Can you imagine? Be seated for a moment. Can you imagine the attack upon his mentality? You're supposed to be the spokesman at Pentecost. You've got the message. You've got a future in your life. You are supposed to be mightily used to me. Oh, I know he didn't have the Holy Ghost yet. I know that. But the principle's the same. I said the principle is the same because some of you, there is a rich future heritage that you have. God's going to use you like you never dreamed to impact your city and to help your local church and to see revival like you've never seen it before. But your past is glaring you in the face and you don't see any way to get above it and beyond it. But some of you for two nights, you have dug in. You have heard everything preached. And you are making a decision. I love him more than football. I love him more than baseball. I love him more than soccer. I love him more than dresses. I love him more than houses. I love him more than land. I love him more than boats. I love him more. I love him more than golf. I love him more than everything. Oh, I'm not preaching you can't have a good time. I believe young people ought to have the greatest time and have a great time having a great time. But I'm telling you here tonight, we better love Jesus more than we love anything else in the world. Peter, I'm going to prophesy. You're not backsliding anymore. I'm prophesying tonight. Some of you are never going back. You'll never smoke again. You'll never drink again. You're never, because mercy is going to catch you. Mercy is about to catch you, young lady. The Lord woke me up at 5:30 a.m. and He said, you preach what I gave you. But there's some young people who have already made mistakes, and they walked out of that building heavy with condemnation. And you get there tonight and you tell them, I love them more than I've ever loved them. And I want to use them more than I've ever used them. Young lady, your mistake is not going to keep you from having an apostolic anointing in your future. Because mercy is about to catch you tonight. Mercy is going to catch you tonight. I'm not going back. That'll be the last time I ever get in the back seat of that car alone with anybody. I won't do that again. I'm caught. Don't get quiet on me. I've got to preach in the Holy Ghost. You'll never get in that position again. You've done it. It's all right. He's forgiven you. But never do it again. There's some young men that are going to preach in America, and thousands are going to get the Holy Ghost. You know why? Right now there's a spirit saying, catch me, Jesus. Catch me, Jesus. Catch me. Catch me. Catch me. But can't nothing catch you like mercy building you a fire. Raise your hands and pray for a moment. He's going to give you children. You're going to raise them in the church. And you're going to be mightily used of God. You're going to be mightily used of God. Why don't you just tell that devil, get behind me tonight. I'm serving a merciful God. And mercy is catching me right now. I'm caught. Be still just a moment. The woman was caught. Don't sit down. I'm almost through. The woman was caught in the very act, her adultery. Have you ever wondered why Jesus knelt down on a knee in the sand? Could it be that mercy was stepping down to her level because that's where her eyes were? Some of you have had your head bowed so low because of your past. But mercy stooped down and began to write something that her eyes could see. When he got up, listen, just a moment, you got to hear the message. When he got up, he didn't address her first. He went right to her accusers. And he said, those of you that doesn't have any sin in your life, go ahead and stone her. Cast the first stone. And rocks got heavy and were dropped in the sand. And one at a time, they started marching away so that only her and Jesus Woman, where are thine accusers? They're not here, they're gone. Neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more. Judgment was trying to catch her, but mercy intercepted, and mercy caught her before judgment could. And tonight, all across this building, mercy has come to catch you. Every head bowed and every eye closed. And after he catches you, make a commitment where he can prophesy. They'll never backslide again. So that Messiah can prophesy. They won't be going back to that anymore. They won't be doing that anymore. Because mercy is going to catch you. These altars are open starting at the back to the front. Come quickly. From the back to the front. Come quickly, quickly, quickly. After he catches you, catch me, Jesus. Catch me, Jesus. Young man, there's a Pentecost waiting on you. There's a Pentecost waiting on you, young lady. There's preachers and missionaries, soul winners and Bible teachers and Sunday school teachers and bus drivers, ministries that are going to be born. And Satan's told you, you can't do it. But mercy is going to catch you. Young lady, you're the one he's preaching to. God, whatever you want me to do, wherever you want me to go,
I could have fallen, my soul cast down.
Oh, yes.
Mercy, rewrote my life.
I'm making a commitment.
Mercy,
if it means a cross, I'll take it. Mercy, 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 catch me, Lord. Young lady, find another young lady. Young man, find another young man and pray one for another all across this
field. I could have fallen, my soul has prayed down.
Some wonder, consider all the worlds thy hands have made. I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. When through the woods and forest glades I wander, and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees, when I look down from lofty mountain grandeur, and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God, his son not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in. That on a cross, my burdens gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. And when Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art.
Jesus, the name above.